Of what we did there, you may or may not have. We are now live, as far as I'm aware. I don't know if we need to do the OTS again. It was very unclear. Okay, we just carry on. Okay, so sorry we're late, everybody. We don't know what happened. We had to shake the Russian awake out of his slumbers, and he does deserve his slumbers. And he drove at a smiling high speed from Inga's house all the way to the final control, and now we are broadcasting to you live from the northeast corner of South Africa here in the Kruger National Park. Now, we've had quite a day already, but before I get into that, my name is James Henry. David is on camera. Hello, David. On the other vehicle, Pajamas Patterson is knocking about in the north, also looking for lions, and she is being filmed, if I'm not mistaken, by the enormous Brian Joubert. You are watching something called Safari Live, if you're wondering. Normally, we would have started at 6 o'clock, but of course, there's an inevitable difficulty with broadcasting a high-definition signal out of the middle of the African wilderness, but here it comes to you live and in high definition. Now, we have had a morning, like I say, we had some reports of lions drinking at the pan yesterday evening, and apparently the lions came three times. There are tracks of a lioness on this road here. Before we decide if or not to follow them, I must just tell you that we did find three cubs early this morning as we came onto this road, just on their own though, three of them completely on their own. That's not unusual if the adults have gone hunting, but it is unusual that they should be on their own, and that it's the two really small ones, so they're about 7 weeks old now, maybe almost 8 weeks old, and then one slightly larger one. Let me try and show, I'm just trying to get into a position where I can show you what I'm looking at, because the road is a little uneven here. And so the task this morning is to try and find where the rest of the Inkahuma pride is. When one is getting out of the car at some fresh tracks, and when there are cubs in the offing, one looks around a little bit first for fear of being shouted at. Okay. Now, it's not very clear, but at least two lionesses have walked down this road. Davy, I don't think you can even see this. Can you see there?
Yeah, we see it.
Okay, there you are. There's a lioness track, everyone. And there's... I'm trying to ascertain if one is a male. No. It's only lioness tracks. And the only way we tell the difference, of course, is from the size of the tracks. There's another one coming down here. There she is.
A little more hard to see that one.
A little harder. How about this one here?
Yeah, we can make it up.
Okay. So I think they've gone back basically towards where the cubs are, so that's good. We're going to do a little loop around this way. Rexon's going that way, and then we'll hopefully be lucky. The block inside here is tremendously full of sticks and things, and it's very difficult to get into. Anyway, that's the plan. Do talk to us over the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Be nice to talk to you. And while we continue this sort of search here, let's head across to Jamie and find out what tracks she has for you.
No tracks just yet, but a very good morning to all of you on another glorious spring morning here in the African bush. And just have a look, while we're looking at this incredible view of the sun, at the sunspots on it. Absolutely amazing, those two little black dots there that you can see. The clouds keep scudding across. It's actually a strange morning this morning. There's a couple of clouds around. I'm hoping they're going to stick around, but most likely they're probably going to burn off. And we're going to have another blisteringly hot day. We always get a little bit excited when we see clouds, just in case they might bring the possibility of rain. But I don't think these clouds are going to linger for very long. I think they're going to burn off and disappear. A very good morning to all of you. My name is Jamie, and this morning we have the wonderful Brian Joubert on camera, and of course, the Thumb, as always, making his appearance. Oh, we don't have any set plans for the morning. Of course, we're going to help James out with finding those Nkuhumas, much like, well, all of you, I imagine. We are concerned about the whereabouts of the little cubs. I've no doubt now that the Nkuhumas have just left the cubs to go off and hunt. A hunt is not a safe place for a lion cub to be. Oh dear. Brian, would you like some help there? Brian has just revealed the bottom of the camera that has dropped, well, the bottom of the tripod that has dropped off. That's most unfortunate. Would you like me to hold the camera?
It's all good.
Okay. Well done. Deary me. Oh, hope none of you are motion sick, sort of prone. Have a look at the sky quickly. There's some trees.
Yeah.
Brian says, let's link, please, because this is impossible. So we're going to send you back across to James and try and fix the camera.
Oh, many gremlins here this morning, everyone. We will no doubt fix the camera shortly. I hope it is a new camera after all, David. Okay, let's just give you the lie of the land here. It's quite nice to just give you a little bit of a descriptor. That road over there that you can see, that clearing, which you wouldn't see in the summertime, you're only seeing it now because of the lack of vegetation and leaves. That is Wahlberg's Eagle's Nest Road, which is a bit of a mouthful. But that's where the Wahlberg's Eagle's Nest is. Many of you would have seen the pale form Wahlbergs either with me yesterday or Jamie, I think, 2 days before that. And they're building frantically there. Then, as Dave pans to the right-hand side, that area there is the area in front of quarantine clearings. And then if we just zoom in straight down this road, Dave. There we go. And just a little bit to the left. There, sorry, that's it. You can see there maybe the roof in the top right-hand corner of the picture. There we are. That's the Galago, or that's actually Vuitela. So just in front of that is the camp. And between where we are sitting now on Central Road, Wahlberg's Eagle's Nest Road, and that Vuitela camp there, and the dam just to the south of it, there is an enormous sort of very, what should we say, thick thicket. Where two drainage lines meet, where the drainage line that leads out of the Vuyatela Dam meets the great Mluamati, and they cascade their way down to the south. And it is at that confluence, I believe, that these lion tracks have gone. So Rexon is now in that area, having a look-see. Three lioness tracks going down this road, and I think they're going to go off towards the south. But I just need to make sure that they don't go off towards the north. Hello, Natasha. You say, oh my, these cubs are going to drive us crazy. I tend to agree with you. It's not, it's not easy at all to cope with this kind of situation. And I'm fascinated by what happened yesterday, by them losing those other two. I think it's bizarre. And I wonder if they haven't found them. I think it's bizarre that three of them are on their own there. Without the rest of the cubs, it's not unusual for the pride to go hunting, but I think it is unusual for them to split the pride up. I don't know why they would have done that. That does seem rather strange. And if you do hear the squealing of brakes, I am sorry. It is a problem with this car that we need to fix. Hello, Ellen in Arkansas. Now, this is the nexus, you see, between human emotion and animal, and where does one draw the line, and how does one understand what they feel? So you say, if the cubs are lost, would the mothers not be hysterical? Would they not be running around calling frantically? They would probably for a while. But the question is, and we were discussing this in camp last night, with eight cubs of all different ages, And because they all cross-suckle, do they actually realize that there are any missing, A? Jamie's of the opinion that their inability to count means that they don't realize, possibly not initially anyway. And secondly, I mean, a lion can be pretty mercenary. A lion can be pretty mercenary when they've got an injured cub or something like that. They won't stay with the cub until it dies. They'll just leave it. And so if a cub falls behind or disappears and they lose it, I don't know how much, you know, sort of hysteria they show. And certainly if you watch, I mean, I've watched leopards lose cubs before. And there seems to be an element of emotional, I don't know that it's ever hysteria, but there must be an emotion. How we would describe it in our human terms, I'm really not sure. Because, yes, I suppose they could feel a certain amount of sadness. I suppose that's possible, because I don't think that the strong instinct to motherhood would exist unless there was a certain amount of sadness. So I'm not really sure. There's a little road that goes in here down into the drainage, and we're just going to see, pop along it and see if we can't see something along there. But it's a really good question, and I don't know the answer to it, and I think certainly, you know, 10 years ago it was extremely unfashionable in the world of science to try and put any kind of human emotion onto an animal like a lion. But I don't know about now. I'm beginning to think more and more that they're quite emotional creatures. Let's go across to Jamie. She seems to have fixed her camera, and find out what she's doing.
I'll be happy to hear that all is well once again, and the camera is now level. Well done to Brian, who managed to sort that out in basically the blink of an eye. And look who we have stumbled upon. I wonder if they know where the lions are. I bet they do. These are the big buffalo bulls that we spoke about on the sunset safari yesterday, and the possibility of the lions potentially hunting them as they were hanging out around Vuyatela Dam. They all look present and accounted for, though, and not particularly on edge. I don't think the lions tried their luck with these enormous buffalo at any point in the last few hours. And this particular male buffalo is absolutely enormous. He is huge. They always look at you. I think it was James who described it. They always look at you as if you owe them money. They have a distinctly disgruntled air about them. And that's not all for show. They are one of the most dangerous animals to encounter on foot. It's because they generally tend to be quite bad-tempered. I think it's more, actually, that people often take them by surprise. They spend a lot of time wallowing in mud, lying down in strange places. And as a result, when people find them, it's usually a little bit too close. A massive buffalo bull like this one definitely comes as an unpleasant surprise. He's still in quite good condition, actually, apart from the odd skin disease. You can see there the balding patches. Pretty much all of the buffalo have these patches where they've been fallen foul to some kind of fungal infection or a mange-type infection like the one that the Styx cubs have. And places where they've just, it's obviously itchy, and they've just rubbed away their fur there. You can see he's balding, and buffalo pattern baldness is a nice way to describe it, I think. Each one has a sort of a unique combination of bald patches around their sides and their bellies and their faces. All buffalo will have a bald patch around their eyes where they've rubbed the preorbital gland against trees and other things like that. That's basically over the years rubbed away the fur. This buffalo is not looking as good. You can see it's doing exactly what the elephants have been doing, which is trying to push around fallen trees and dead trees, because that's where the best food is. Oh, shame. Look at his tatty ears. This is a buffalo bull that's been through the wars. I'm sure he has many, many stories to tell. And of course, despite the constant presence of ox pickers on the buffalo, they have numerous ticks around the more sensitive regions. You can see there between his front legs, if you look carefully, you'll see there's lots and lots of shiny engorged ticks that have settled on him. It would drive me absolutely crazy. I don't know how they manage it. Oh, imagine that. Oh. One tick is itchy enough. I don't know how the buffalo don't, or any animal, doesn't go completely nuts. I suppose they're so used to it. I mean, you don't have thumbs. There's not much they can do. This buffalo bull not in the best of conditions. You can see his hip bones are starting to protrude. It's interesting how some are harder hit than others. That's probably age-related. He's probably slightly older than the one that we were looking at initially. Or potentially infected with tuberculosis. And therefore, as soon as he starts to lose condition, the symptoms start to manifest and his health deteriorates quicker. Definitely. You can see there's a definite contrast between the buffalo on the left and the buffalo on the right. Much healthier looking buffalo. The one thing that it does do, a drought in this situation, is it does weed out the weaker genetics. Cindy in North Carolina, speaking of buffalo, you wanted to know whether we've seen the buffalo nicknamed Taylor Lautner. Brian, you were the one who came up with that. Yes. You were the one that figured out exactly why that buffalo looked so familiar to all of us. We passed him by many, many times, trying to figure out why the buffalo looked like somebody that we knew. And it was Brian who finally managed to pinpoint who it was. No, I haven't seen the buffalo that looks like Taylor Lautner, actually. Have you, Brian?
No, not recently.
No, I haven't seen him recently at all. Brian, of course, is a genius, because it was really bugging us exactly who that buffalo looked like. So I haven't seen the Taylor Lautner buffalo. He's very, very distinctive, for those of you who are wondering what on earth we are talking about, because that must sound utterly bizarre, because how on earth could a buffalo look like Taylor Lautner? Well, he does. I'm just telling you right now, he does. He's got a very straight boss. Now, the boss is the base of the horns, the thick, bony part where the two horns join. It is essentially the buffalo bull's battering ram. And in Taylor Lautner's buffalo case, be careful, we're going to get sued. We're going to get shouted at, taken to court for defamation. I should just sort of say as a disclaimer, I don't think that buffalo is in any way unattractive. I don't know. I don't quite know how to cover myself there. Dear Taylor Lautner, no offense meant, he's a lovely buffalo. Anyway, he's got a very straight boss. And that boss is solid bone. And actually, probably for the Taylor Lautner buffalo, he's probably working to his advantage, having that boss so low down over his eyes, because it just provides extra protection and extra cover. And females, of course, they have horns, but not nearly as well developed. It is the buffalo bulls that use them to clash with each other. It's very rare to see a serious, serious buffalo fight, but they do clash with each other, and you can imagine how thick that bone is. You're probably talking, just in terms of the boss itself, you're probably talking about 2 inches of solid bone. And then, of course, there's the bone of the skull as well. So it all protects the brain case when they go charging at each other. And just imagine the forces involved when two 800, 900 kilogram buffalo bulls moving at 15 meters per second clash head to head. Gives you an idea of just why they need such a solid base around their horns. And Miss Lynn in North Carolina, very, very good question from you about whether or not the ticks and mange are worse during the dry season. Yes, you'll actually see it with almost, let's cover diseases first. So almost all diseases And a mange is an external parasite as well. It's that horrible little mite that sits in the skin, but it does look like a skin disease. Almost all of those things will be exacerbated. They'll be worse because the animal's immune system, their bodies are not in good condition, so they can't fight them off as well. And the same applies to, I suppose, applies to ticks. I haven't noticed a huge increase in ticks. They're around, but no more so than normal. But one thing that we do notice is that whenever there is a sick animal, their parasite load or their external parasite load immediately goes up. So yes, as soon as the animals lose condition, they will start to have more ticks on them. They're also less energetic in terms of getting rid of them. And we do see buffalo trying to get rid of them. They go and wallow in mud and then have a jolly good scratch. It's hard to imagine, isn't it, what these buffalo balls are eating. Everything just looks so brown and dry. And Desiree and Karen, you were wondering about the skin diseases and whether or not they are contagious and transfer to lions. I guess so. I mean, it makes sense that they would be. Obviously, it would be in a situation, I assume, that you're thinking of where the lion is hunting the buffalo. And yes, I suppose it is entirely possible that the lions could pick up a skin disease or something similar from a buffalo bull. Most of the time, those lions will be infected anyway, particularly with TB. But that's not really what you asked, though, is it? Because you asked about skin diseases. But TB does transfer from the different animals, just in saliva and mucus. But yes, I suppose it's possible that lions could pick up skin diseases from buffalo that they've killed. It's very, very close contact, I suppose, in those scenarios. Our buffalo are slowly disappearing off, and the sun is breaking through that thin layer of cloud. It's burning away, and I think it's promising to be another very hot day. Oh, we found buffalo that have survived the hunting lions. I think we're going to go and search for those lions now. See if perhaps they haven't popped out towards Galago Pan. They must be somewhere around. There seem to be tracks everywhere, in every direction. Speaking of ticks, Lala, you want to know, do we check ourselves for ticks every single day? Yes. Sort of standard, have a double check every now and again. There's nothing like that horrible moment when you wake up and you get into the shower or something similar and you discover a tick that has made its way to a nice safe spot somewhere on your body. Oh, you always feel so incredibly, I always feel incredibly, I don't know what the word is, offended. My worst was when I woke up and I found a tick that was dangling from my eyelid. It was horrible. Oh, I hate ticks. They love me. But yes, we'll all do a sort of a mandatory tick check. Brent can't walk past a blade of grass, it seems, without getting tick bite fever. I'm pretty sure he's had tick bite fever 3 times in the time that I've known him. I've only ever had tick bite fever once. It was long ago. I somehow managed to weather the tick bites a little bit better. The theory, the statistic is meant to be that 1 in every 1,000 ticks is a carrier of tick bite fever. I'm not sure I believe that, because I've definitely had many, many thousands of ticks. That's a slight exaggeration. And I have not yet had I've had one bout of tick bite fever. Okay, as we trundle along back towards Galago Pan, let's go back over to James and see if he's had any more luck with his lion search.
We've had no further luck, I'm afraid, everyone, but I am very pleased that you've managed to find Taylor Lautner again and that Jamie has given you a very in-depth description of the tick removal. Oh, you didn't actually find Taylor Lautner, you just were talking about him. I see. Well, I wonder where Taylor is. Old T-bomb the buffalo. Wonder if he hasn't been taken out by lions. Now, we haven't had any further luck with those little cubs. We didn't go back in there to see if we could find them. As we saw them on their own, and I just assumed the whole pride would be there this morning, but it wasn't. And so what we're going to do is go around onto Twin Dams Road. We did do a fossick about where I said that I thought the tracks were going. Rexon is now in that area on foot, and so with any luck he'll come up with them there. But whatever else there is, we will observe as well. There's some male lion tracks going this way, which is a little bit odd. It's very strange. Laura in Alabama, you're wondering about the effect. Sorry, I'm just trying to find your decent track here. There you will, Dave. You'll see some there. Yep. There are some tracks going south down the road here, but they to me look like they're from yesterday. Can you see them there, Dave? That's them. Male lion tracks. They look to me like they're not particularly fresh, so it could be from yesterday. Laura, you're wondering if that male lion were to come across the three cubs on their own, would he be inspired by a sense of fatherly or unclely duty and take them back to the pride, or would he harm them, or what would he do? I don't think he'd take them back to the pride, but I don't think he'd necessarily harm them either. I mean, I think it's highly unlikely that he would harm them. So I think that'd be okay from a safety point of view, but I don't think he would take it upon himself to reunite them with their mother. And so, yeah, I mean, that's just the role of a male lion, really. He's not a very good dad in the way that we would think of dads being good. Now, they are going along this little game path next to the road here. But I think that's from yesterday. Maybe headed up through there. Let's keep having a look-see. And we'll check on Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg. See how they're doing. And we'll just keep an eye in the bushes here. This is where David said they were yesterday. Not so, David? Yes. Sun is out. It's not very cold today, probably about, I'd say about 17 degrees Celsius or so, which isn't too bad. It's about 63 Fahrenheit. There's a little bit of a wind blowing from the south. Kirsten says it's 1966, but she's in the final control. It's slow on the uptake today. Right, here we are arriving at the home of Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg. Now, I guarantee you that Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg know precisely where the lions are. But unfortunately, I don't speak Swedish, do you? David, do you speak Swedish? No. Now, that is either Mrs. or Mr. Wahlberg. And let's just sit and listen for a little while and see if we can't hear the telltale calling of the cubs. And then David off to the right-hand side is either Mr. or Mrs. Wahlberg again. Bah. Now, yesterday we had the rather amazing view of them mating, believe it or not, just before we came live. It was astounding to watch. And in the background, you can hear one of my favorite bird calls, that of the southern boo-boo. It's two of them. The one going, the other one going. Here she comes. Well spotted, David. Well spotted. I wonder when the eggies will be laid. I'm not sure how soon after mating eggies are laid. Let's go a little bit closer. But it looks a little bit like incubation may be taking place. I can't believe that would have happened already, though. Good morning, Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg. Have you seen any lions? Not. And that almost what am I trying to say? The permanent state of having to look after your feathers if you're going to fly in the air. And that's what Mr. or Mrs. is doing there. It's impossible to tell which is which unless they're standing next to each other. And that's simply because Mrs. is much bigger than Mr. I think this is going to be a wonderful little story to watch unfolding. And like I said yesterday, they did not manage to raise a chick last year. Davy, there's some Franklin's alarm calling up ahead. It could be just because they've seen those Wahlbergs. They're just making a soft ticker, ticker, ticker. Let's just see if they aren't shouting at the Ninka Puma pride. I'm going to ask Kirsten to spell that, please. Because Raisa in Finland has sent us this Finnish. Right, so you might have to help us with the pronunciation here, but you've sent us a message saying that the Swedish for "where are the lions" is "var är lejonen". Lejon? Thank you very much, Raisa. I will ask Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg when we go past them again. Now there are the alarm calling Franklins. You can see the tail is cocked up. That's not the actual one that's alarm calling. The one that's alarm calling is just up ahead. You see it there? It's just coming out into the open there. That's him. He was the one that was going, "Kuze, kuze." He's cocked a little tail. Might be because it's girlfriend's run off with another cockerel. Yes, he seems to be relaxing a little bit as he's found a source of food somewhere close by here. There we are. Peck, peck. All okay. No tracks further. Var är lejonen? I find the Scandinavian accents quite difficult. Lions. Lions. Var är lejonen? There we are. Thank you. I think Google managed to say that. Well done, Google. Var är lejonen? That is impressive. We managed to get that sorted out. And that's quite impressive from Raisa as well, of course, because while you might think that Finnish is closely related to Swedish, as far as I understand, it is very unrelated. Related only to Hungarian, which is something of a linguistic mystery. Thank you, Raisa. I apologize for butchering the pronunciation. There's some very relaxed looking impala, David. They don't look like they're particularly terrified by anything in the way of lions in this vicinity. In fact, one would describe them as positively relaxed. Oh, it's turning into quite a pretty morning now as the light breaks through the clouds. And much in the way of birdsong. Okay, we're going to continue our search for the lions down the rest of this road, see what we come up with. While we do that, let's go and find out what pajamas Patterson has managed to capture on camera in the bush.
We're going to capture a nest on camera in the bush. From the Warburg's eagle's nest to the Shikra nest. Just stopped to see how their progress is going. I'm really hoping they haven't abandoned it, because it doesn't look as though it's got any bigger or any more well-defined. I was really hoping that they were going to stick around here. I think I see an adult, Shikra. I think it's sitting on top of that marula tree right at the back there, but it's far away. Don't abandon us, little guys. Can you see there at the top, right at the back of that? Maybe if I go backwards a little bit. Where are we looking? A little bit further. There we go.
Yeah, go on,
that looks like it. No, that's a pigeon. No, that's definitely not a shikra. That is a pigeon. Roughly the same size. But that is most definitely an African green pigeon and not a shikra. Almost. Almost, but not quite. In my defense, I was looking into the sun, but there isn't really any kind of defense there. So perhaps our shikra are still around. I'm really hoping that they do decide to keep this nest site. A shikra is a lovely, tiny little bird of prey in the goshawk family. It's also known as the little banded goshawk. And it's the perfect season for them to be nesting. In fact, all of our birds of prey at this point will be either in the process of laying eggs or will have already laid their eggs. I know that the African hawk eagles will probably have started nesting on that nest around Central Road. Nope, I don't think so. Nobody's home today. All is quiet at the shikra nest. It's fascinating to watch them build it, because they actually, which I didn't realize, they actually physically break branches off in order to construct that incredibly messy combination that they've got going on there. If nobody's home, we'll have to head out in search of other things. Oh, I see what you mean. Brian was saying to me there's another nest. Oh, that's going to be horrible. Can you manage that, Brian? Looks like a weaver's nest to me. It's always interesting watching... Yeah, that must be one of the weavers. It was interesting watching where the different weaver species build their nests. Red-headed weavers seem to love power lines, for example, whereas the southern masked weavers very often around the dams. Cool. That, I think, is abandoned. That doesn't look like anybody's home. What often happens is the male weaver builds his nest and then decides, actually, that's not the best spot for it, and moves off and goes to a different spot. So he might have a couple of trial runs before the actual nest that he invests his time and energy on. Almost like practicing, I suppose. I decided I'd sort of stretch further afield to try and track down these lions. Unfortunately, it hasn't paid off, and the only thing I've been tracking down or seeing the tracks of is James and I think it must be Dave and Jandre on their run yesterday. You can see their tracks all the way along Zoe's road. Very brave of them. Apparently they did it in the midday sun as well. Okay. So far, this side of Juma is incredibly quiet. I don't think... Have you seen one animal on Zoe's road, Brian? I don't think so. No, I don't think we did. It seems to be devoid. Can't be devoid of animal life. They've got to be here somewhere. Perhaps it's the strange weather that's unsettling them. Brian, it might even be earlier rain than we thought. No, surely not. I hope so, but I don't think so. Very peculiar, cloudy day. I said the clouds were burning off. They've taken their time, though. Ah. Hearing exciting things on the Game Drive channel, but I'm not going to tell you what I'm hearing. James's voice was definitely involved. Well, we can safely say that the lions did not come this way. However, James has had a slightly more of a fortunate time in terms of his search for creatures, and he's managed to find you something very large and very grey.
Well, it's not very large. It is grey, but it is a youngster. Only about, 8 years or so. And two young bulls, I think, here, feeding on their own, away from asserting some form of independence, away from mum and the herd, which is just off to the right-hand side of where you're looking now. There we are. Very nice whip pan there, David. Whip. So I think we'll just sit here for a little while. I'll give you an update on the lions. Is that Rex has got tracks going north and south, which is always very confusing. He thinks maybe they've killed something somewhere in the block here. So he's going to continue following, and that's why he thinks they've left those cubs there, which I think is a pretty good thought. There's a rather delightful smell in the air, and I'm not sure what it is. But it really is quite pleasant. Look at the light, just catching our little elephant friend there. And these little tusks, you can see he's a bull by the fact that his tusks have turned outwards. And he's eating, there's quite a lot of tamburti and knobthorn here. Tamburti, obviously not particularly toxic to elephants, very toxic to us, but seemingly to elephants not so much. Him chewing away there. Hello Benji in Los Angeles. You are wondering about the camel thorn and whether we get it here. Benji, we don't get the camel thorn here. The camel thorn is found only in areas that are much drier than this. So you'll find them in Botswana, for example, in the Kalahari. You'll find them up into the delta because they don't get a huge amount of rain there. But you'll also find them extensively through Namibia. But Benji, they don't occur here. It's an acacia, of course, the camel thorn, Acacia aerialoba. It's probably now Vachellia, actually, given that the Australians have decided that we can't use the term acacia anymore. It was quite nasty of them, wasn't it, David? You don't have to agree with me, David. You can tell me you think I'm talking rubbish. You will be wrong, of course, but you can try. And there... It's a nice, very pleasant dawn chorus, a very quiet one, but we've got crested Franklins as well. Hello, Andrew in Vermont. Very nice to hear from you again. You say, what is my favorite elephant herd? Unquestionably, I mean, actually, you know, until very recently, that would have been quite difficult for me to answer. But unquestionably, my favorite elephant herd at the moment is that short trunk herd, with that beautiful cow who's lost most of her trunk, or certainly she's lost a third of her trunk or so, and she's got two youngsters and I think a sibling that live with her. And she's very young, she's probably only about 22 or 23, and she's made a little herd, and she's made a great success of her life. And they've overcome quite severe challenges, I feel, and I think she's lovely to watch, and I enjoy watching the sort of story of their lives unfolding. Now, there are quite a few more elephants in there, quite a few larger ones, and I think that big elephant there, Davi, is the matriarch of this little herd. I'm just going to wait to see if they come out. Hello, Wanda Twin Flames, all the way in Oregon. Thank you for getting hold of us. You say thank you for this gift. Well, Wanda, this gift wouldn't exist without people like you who interact with us and watch and give us of your time. So thank you to you for allowing us to do the work that we do. And Wanda, you want to know if elephants ever have twins. They do sometimes. It's very rare. It's probably even more rare than it is with human beings, but it does occur every so often. I'm not sure that I've ever seen it. I have seen cows with similarly aged calves before, or this sort of look exactly the same, but it's very difficult to say whether those are twins or not. And it's difficult to say because, of course, you haven't seen them being born. So it could just be because they're in the herd and they're the same age, they're just wandering around with the same cow. But it has certainly been recorded, Wanda. I'm not going to move here because, of course, we'll disturb him. So I think we're just going to sit here and enjoy these wonderful, wonderful sightings. Ali, you say, are elephants' tusks wider between the... wider between the trunk and the tusks? Are the bulls wider than the cows? Or is it just you? I don't know if it's just you. I'm not sure, Ali, about your trunk and your tusks and whether they are wider apart or not. Sorry, I'm just being facetious. But Ali, yes, there is a difference. You'll find that the males normally have got tusks that push outwards, and the cows normally straight down. But it really is not a hard and fast rule, and I have seen plenty of elephants that break that rule entirely. So while I would say that these are two bulls, you can see if that one has his tusks slightly pointing outwards, but the other one much more so. So it's a good observation, and certainly it is true to a certain extent, but it isn't a universal sort of rule of thumb. There are lots of them in this herd that are about this age, sort of, I'd say, 8 to 10 years old. I think it's worth just sitting here for a little while, everybody. Well, I mean, we can't actually go anywhere. We can't go forward because we'll give this chap a fright. So I think we'll just wait here and enjoy. You can hear some breaking of trees going on. That's already a broken tree. There we are. He's just pushing it out the way, actually, and finding if there isn't anything sort of delicious underneath, perhaps. The sun just coming out again. You can see it changing the light on them. Hello, Dara, here in Ohio, and you're wondering if elephants ever sleep. Elephants do sleep, Dara. But we don't think for very long, and especially because the bigger you are, apparently the less you have to sleep. Now, we learnt the other day that a giraffe probably only sleeps for about 30 minutes of the day, which is a tiny amount. Elephants, as far as I'm aware, big bull elephants, for example, will probably only sleep for, say, 3 hours a day. And I think these youngsters a bit more than that. But basically, the bigger you are, the slower your mass-specific metabolic rate is. In other words, the slower your metabolism is, and therefore, the shorter you have to sleep. But there are various other factors that affect that. And my understanding is that big bull elephants, yeah, probably about 3 hours. And, you know, that sort of increases probably for the very small ones, maybe up to 8 hours for a very tiny one. There we go, there's a slightly larger one coming out into the open on the right there, Dave. There we are. And just trying to eke out some kind of food from the last bits of greenery. You can see most of the trees already have had their bark stripped. And so that chap's having to have a taste of bark that has already been sampled. This is a tremendously confiding little group of elephants, I'll tell you. They're not vaguely affected by our presence, which I think is rather exciting. It can be exciting in an entirely different way, of course, if they are alarmed by your presence. See that? Just pulling off the last bits of the bark there. Hello, Marilee and Illinois. You want to know if the elephants will cross-suckle, allo-suckle, in the same way that lions do? As a rule, no, they don't. Has there ever been a record? I have no doubt there is a record of it happening, a sort of wet nursing record. But what does happen, of course, is that if the mother dies, then we know that there will be a certain amount of allo-suckling, if you like. So if there is a lactating female, she will adopt a youngster. So any calf that is abandoned or orphaned will be adopted by another suckling cow within the herd. So that is a form of allo suckling, I suppose. But they don't, as with the lions, just cross-suckle by default. And one animal that won't at all cross-suckle, for example, is a hyena. So it lives in a big group where often there are multiple lactating females. Only the cub's mother will allow a cub to suckle from her. You can't believe how quiet they are. There are probably about 10 elephants here. Here we go, Dave. Here comes another youngster up towards us. Hello, Arna. You're in Atlanta and you want to know if birds ever, and not birds, if elephants ever molest birds' nests by mistake and toss them out of trees, perhaps. Yes, and get attacked, you say, by birds. I've certainly seen elephants being dive bombed by things like crowned lapwings and blacksmith lapwings, and they don't like it. They really don't like it at all. It's a bit like a bit ridiculous, but it's a bit like when they feel the feeling of a cracked egg on the skin. They really hate that. And so they don't like being dive bombed by birds. But I think it's mostly the ground birds, you know, that will give them trouble, because of course they are often with the ground birds. Here comes this fellow. He's bored, you see. He's coming to see us. Hello, Mr. Elephant. I'm going to take a picture of you with my telephone. Yes. See, he wants to be on screen. And he's bored. I'm telling you, he's just bored out of his mind, walking around and eating. And so now he's got a little bit of company, and he doesn't really know what it is and what it's doing. But I think he's just a bit interested in us. Oh, hello. Isn't that cool? I think that's such fun. And he's a youngster, so we're not worried at all. Here comes a young cow. Talking to each other. It's a young cow crossing the road now. They're right up close here. And she's a bit older than the other, than the bulls, and you can see them moving out the way, but she's certainly, I think she's, yeah, she looks about 20 or so. She certainly has had a calf before. We can see that from her pectoral mammy, if you like. Here, I think this is the calf here. Dave just coming off to the right hand side. There we go, just going to join Mum now. All right, Jamie's got some interesting birds to show you. Let's go and take a look at them.
We have some interesting birds indeed, which could in turn mean something else interesting. Some white-backed vultures have gathered around Weaver's Nest Road. And the question is, are they here for a reason, or are they just roosting in the dead tree? Of course, vultures have to wait for the day to heat up before they can take off and head off and fly up in their spiraling circles. That's because they use... What have you got on your beak? It's got a... Oh, it's a spider web. What they do is they wait for the warm air to start rising, and then they fly along using the air currents. And basically, because they are very bulky, heavy birds, it's the most energy-efficient way for them to fly. So whilst they can fly now by heavy flapping of their wings, for the most part they're quite content to sit in the dead trees and wait for the day to heat up ever so slightly. Brian pointed out that these two vultures look as though they've just had one serious disagreement. I'm not sure what they were fighting about, but they just look like they've got the sulks with each other. They're not talking to each other. Nope, I'm not looking at you. I'm not even talking to you. I'm just going to preen my feathers. And generally, vultures tend to sit on the dead trees because it's an easier spot for them. They don't have to worry about being caught up in leaves or anything like that. That being said, at the moment, they're a bit spoiled for choice, because none of the trees, or very few of the trees, actually have leaves. Now the question is, are they just here? Or is there a reason behind it? Because there's actually more vultures a little way off. What sometimes happens is vultures gather for a kill, or they gather to feed, and then they go and they roost a little way away. They were sitting with a battalier while you were with James and the elephant. Unfortunately, our battalier very inconsiderately decided that it didn't want to associate with the riffraff that is a vulture. Not that they are riffraff at all. And decided to move off. So they're the other three. There's a hooded one as well. So we've got a nice combination of four white-backed vultures and one hooded vulture, who's currently contorting himself in all kinds of interesting positions to try and groom. Wings stretched out as it fixes up its primary feathers. You can hear the battalier calling, but it's decided us. Susan, you wanted to know whether or not vultures ever hunt at all, or whether it is a purely carrion-based diet. As far as I know, it is a purely carrion-based diet. They're such bulky birds that they're not agile at all. They're not built for speed or catching anything. I haven't heard of vultures catching or hunting anything.
I've checked Spaghetti Crossing by Satellite.
Okie dokie. I'm going to send you back across to James. There's something happening with our audio, and we'll catch up with you shortly.
These elephants are all over the place, apparently. We're sitting with one herd here, and where Rexon is trying to track the lions, the elephants have sort of obliterated the tracks. Anyway, he's still trying. She's got a rather odd-looking tooth there. Not much orthodontic help in the elephant world. Right, let us go a little bit forward. Now, apparently there are elephants all over this area right now. So we'll go a little bit forward. See what we can... See if we can't get another view. There's one following us from the left. Very sweet little thing. Hello, Maggie in Vancouver. I'm not sure of the answer to your question exactly, but you say, do elephants ever get ear infections? I imagine they do, and I tell you why I imagine they do, is that sometimes you do see elephants that are either shaking their heads in the same way that a dog does when its ears are infected. Ah, wonderful. And also, they scratch their ears quite a lot with their trunks, I think, when they're a little bit irritated. Are they very severe? Who knows? I'm not sure. I think lots of ear infections and other things like that, of course, that domestic dogs and domestic animals get are brought on by strange diets and stresses and things that wild animals don't necessarily feel. It's the same chap who was visiting us earlier. He's just bored. And he'd rather spend a bit of time with us because he knows that his whole day is going to be taken up. Unbelievable how often that happens. His whole day is going to be taken up by the difficult process of finding sufficient food to eat. That, everybody, is why I am known by the very, very complimentary nickname of the Bush Laxative. When I look at an animal, it relieves itself. Alright, I think let's carry on a little bit down the road here. And while we do that, Jamie has got some more elephants to show you.
While we've been sitting with the vultures, a lovely herd of elephants has come bolting out of the bushes. I at first thought that was Benjamin, but it's not. It's just a little baby elephant of a similar age. And you, mister? You're full of nonsense. Yes. Off you go. Everybody else is there. Go catch up with them. I actually saw these elephants earlier. I forgot to mention it, but... Oh, yes, very scary. Very scary. That's a pipe. Leave the pipe alone. I actually saw these elephants earlier, and they were sprinting away from us. Not away from us specifically, but just they just happened to be running. And I think it's because they've got a very, very large bull with them that's been causing a bit of nonsense. was such a curious moment there from that elephant. How awesome was that? He just wanted to investigate what was going on there. Touching it with his trunk and then his feet. Thank you for not breaking the pipe, mister. But yes, they were running away from us in a completely the opposite direction to where we are now, and they've all of a sudden decided to pop out here. And I don't know what it is that had them so unsettled. It must be that big bull. Tex is just a little bit away from us now. At least they've relaxed a bit. The female's busy suckling the calf. As I said, Texan's not far from us now. He's surrounded by them. We've managed to find ourselves a prime spot to stop and watch their goings on. That's gorgeous. Of course, the bond between mom and youngster is exceptionally strong. Georgia, you wanted to know if a female died giving birth, whether or not one of the elephants would adopt her calf. And the answer is no, probably not. It's highly unlikely, and most likely that little calf would die in probably the space of a couple of hours, because of course it needs to have that first suckle within the first few hours of its life. Get its strength up to be able to keep up with the rest of the herd. So no, as far as I know, there are no recorded cases of elephants allo-suckling. I've never heard of it. Or surrogating mothers. It's an interesting question though, because I suppose, no, I've never heard of it happening. Very, very unlikely. And elephants get, occasionally elephant calves do get confused and they go and try and suckle from one of the females. And they're met with, that is not their mother, of course, and they are met with seriously disgruntled responses, often getting kicked and pushed away. And there's our young male. Quite an impressive set of tusks he's got for a little boy. Using them to break apart the acacia trees. It's always remarkable to me, no matter how many times I see it, just how incredibly tough those animals' mouths are. And look at those thorns. About 2 inches long, and really seriously sharp. And he's just slowly packing them away. I need to reposition ever so slightly. Tex is on his way past us. And while we do, let's go across to James, who's got something much, much smaller than an elephant.
Unfortunately, as with most of sightings of Dika, they pose beautifully for the camera until you're live, and then they go behind a bush. A little Dika ewe. She may well be making a Dika lamb. And I think Dika would probably give birth round about the same time as the rest of the antelope out here, the height of the rainy season. But she was just so beautifully framed by the Tamboti trees here in pale sort of lemon and honey-coloured leaves on the ground below her, and the sun filtering through the trees, which unfortunately has now gone behind a cloud. Not unfortunately, it's very fortunate actually, given the temperature that it has been. Spectacular Dika sighting, wasn't that, David? Very nice. At least we still have a picture of it, and you can see how well hidden it is. Oh, here it is, going to come out to the open now, where it was to begin with. Come on. That's very artistic, David. See if she comes down again. And I think she's probably eating quite a lot of the old leaf litter there. Hello, Nicholas in Oklahoma. You're asking an interesting question about whether or not a predator would avoid a pregnant animal, perhaps, in order to make sure that the food source that it seeks becomes larger. No, absolutely not. Can they sense, though, whether an animal is pregnant? I don't know. Can a leopard sense if a nyala is pregnant when she's hunting it? I'm going to say no, I don't think so, but we can categorically say that they don't avoid pregnant animals because often we've seen, especially at the end of pregnancy when the females find it a little bit more difficult to move because they're very heavy, obviously, we see that often pregnant females get killed, and it is, well, can be quite a traumatic thing to watch, of course, because sometimes we do see the fetus sometimes semi-alive, actually, and especially if you're watching wild dogs, that can be a little bit nasty to watch. They definitely don't avoid pregnant animals. Do they know if they're pregnant or not? I think there's probably a chance they do, but I'm not sure that they worry about it at all. Thank you, Nicholas. We're going to continue down the Umluamati drainage now, see what we can find in here. Rex thought maybe the lions had come down here, but he had to turn around because there were so many elephants where he was tracking. Ah, David, this is something we haven't discussed for a while. You say, why are dikers all alone? And the same reason could be advanced for why steenbok are alone, why bushbuck are normally alone. And what you will notice there, of course, why dik-dik are always alone, why klipspringer are always alone, and why all the small antelope are always alone. Basically, the way to describe it is this. If you are very small, like a diker or a steenbok, then you can hide. You are small enough to be able to hide. And therefore, so let's just leave it there to start with. And then, if you are larger, say impala or nyala sized, it becomes difficult for you to hide because you're too big. You're too big to completely disappear into the bush. And so, what happens is, when you are very small, the advantages of being alone and able to hide outweigh the disadvantages of not having extra vigilance by being in a herd. When you're, say, the size of an impala, the disadvantages of being in a herd, in other words, more obvious, are outweighed by the advantages of the extra eyes and noses, the extra vigilance afforded by being in a herd. So I hope that explains it. Basically, the smaller you are, the easier it is to hide, and therefore the more advantageous it is to be alone. The bigger you are, the more obvious you are, and therefore the more you need to be able to look around to see if there are any predators coming to get you. And that's basically why impala are in herds. And anything bigger is going to be in a group of sorts, and everything smaller is going to be in a very small group, or in a couple, or completely solitary. Nice question. Thank you, David. I hope that answers the question for you. It certainly makes sense to me, that explanation. Hello, Vulpine Wolf Girl. Quite a nice sort of eerie sounding name. Vulpine Wolf Girl, you want to know if we have anything in the way of birds that would kill a major, would be able to kill. Vulpine Wolf Girl is yes. The Marshall Eagle will be able to kill something the size of a vulture or a steenbok, and even a baby impala. So Marshall Eagle, Crowned Eagle as well. We don't really get them here, but it's possible to see them here. And those would be the animals that would kill something like a steenbok, or a diker, or a baby impala. Vulpine Wolf Girl. You get some really good Twitter handles. That's one of them. Rexon is still trying to follow up on those lions. I don't know where they've gone. I wonder if they're not sitting on a kill somewhere quite far from where we think they are, and that the tracks may have been obliterated by the elephants. Now, it's quite often, of course, now that with the cubs, they won't necessarily take.
But our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully, we'll be back with you shortly. but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly. Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
That is the male version of the Nyala. Once again, we apologise for the technical issues. Not sure what's going on. I suspect something to do with the fact that we've just moved the entire final control, and we're now fine-tuning things to a fine point. Anyway, there is a young bull Nyala, and he will be related, I've almost no doubt, to that cow we were watching earlier. Probably two siblings, or maybe even three, but none of them big mature bulls yet. They won't be quite so friendly when they're adults. And here's an interesting one. We were chatting with David about how sort of size makes a difference to whether an animal wants to live in a herd or not. And these bulls will live in a group despite the fact that they dislike each other for many months of the year when they're trying to mate with females. That is all overcome because the advantage of being in a group that is able to look around for things that might want to bite you is far, far more advantageous than the disadvantage of being around a sort of sexual rival, if you like. But this time of the year, everything is pretty much at peace. You know, there's not enough food around for them to be doing anything other than looking for food, and nobody's trying to mate at the moment, so everyone's quite friendly. And I think you'll find at this time of the year, conflict in antelope society is probably vastly reduced. Certainly they seem to be at peace, don't they, David?
Yes.
Very peaceful. Lovely sounds all around us. Robin going. The ubiquitous crested barbet. The African sun on my face. Very nice. Still no lions or evidence of them. Right, we'll keep looking around here. Jamie Patterson, I think, has got something interesting to tell you, so let's go and find out what it is.
My interesting news is that the Queen of Juma has once again returned. She's crossed back into this area. So the Queen of Juma, being the female leopard Ukurula, Her Royal Highness, and she's gone into one of her favorite patches between Weaver's Nest and Twin Dams. We're scouting extra specially carefully to see whether or not she's popped out here. The difficulty is that these elephants that we were with earlier, they're still round, they're slowly making their way in this direction. And it means that it's going to be very, very difficult to go out and walk and track her. Whether it's for Rexon or for myself, they're very unsettled. They're not happy elephants. I think it's largely due to that bull. But it could be that they can smell Karula as well. And they're just constantly, they're moving in a very unpredictable way. Backwards, forwards, up and down. It'd be tricky to track her down in this block. But I'm hoping she might pop out somewhere during the course of the sunrise safari. Have a look-see. This is her one of her favorite trees, this beautiful bright green boerbean. A lovely flash of green in an otherwise very brown and grey landscape. One of my favorite trees too. The boerbean. Name Boer, the name for the farmers of the area. So boerbean, because they made coffee out of the seed. And they also have a beautiful, it's called a weeping boerbean, because they have beautiful red flowers that give off copious amounts of sap. And Tammy, you were wondering when will we start to see the flowers blooming. We're already starting to see one or two. The knobthorns are blooming. If we look, have a look a little bit, we just have a look at the tree that's off to the right there of the boerbean. That's got flowers. Not the knobthorn flowers are not the prettiest flowers in the world, but it is a flower, and it's also edible. It actually tastes quite nice. And then over the next few weeks or so, we'll see the things like the boerbeans start to flower. The tree wisteria, Gendre spotted the first flowering tree wisteria a couple of days ago, which is one of my favorite flowers. It's beautiful, a purple, like wisteria. Essentially, that's where the name comes from. So those beautiful dangling purple flowers. And we're going to be seeing it shortly. Knobthorns are flowering. The knobthorns will soon get leaves. It'll be very, very pleasant. Oh, that's a beautiful picture. There's another boerbean on the other side of the termite, on the other side of the drainage line. The elephants have just arrived underneath it. They'll try and get us a view. And reaching up to feed on off it. Stunning. They might actually push Queen Karula out of this block as well. Can you sort of see from there, Bebop? That's so beautiful. Hello, Elise. The big bull was reaching right up into the boughs of the boerbean. Ha! Huh, he heard me say that, though, because he stopped. Oh, there we go. Sorry, not the big bull, a cow, female elephant. Stretching with just the tip of her trunk, trying to, oh, she managed it. She managed to grab a branch. Oh, and now the whole tree is, well, not the whole tree, but the whole one side of the tree was swaying there as she tries to pull it down. Whoa. Donna, a big bull will need to eat around 300 kilograms of food a day. So what is that? That's about 60 odd pounds. The younger elephants or the females will probably eat a little bit less than that. So you're looking at around 200 or so kilograms per day. Just imagine that. Imagine how much eating you need to do to eat that much food. Is incredible. It is the big male. I wasn't going crazy. That constant need to feed. Imagine if you just walked around and were able to eat everything around you. because that's essentially what elephants do. And that's why they constantly feed, to maintain their enormous body size. And of course their digestive system is very inefficient, so they excrete about half of what they eat as waste material. The rest of the eddies coming to join in. Only the bull is tall enough, though, to reach up to the tip-tops of this boobin and pull the leaves down. I wonder if there's a better place to see this. I don't think so. I think this is as good as the view gets. They seem to have relaxed a little bit now as well. And Rachel, you want to know whether or not elephants really do have good hearing, like in Horton Hears a Who. I was trying to answer that really cleverly by doing it in the Dr. Zeus style, but I'm not very good on it. Good at it. Rachel, they do have very, very good hearing, perhaps not quite the level that Horton does, as portrayed by Dr. Zeus, but they do have exceptionally good hearing, and there's some interesting research happening into their sub-frequency or their low-frequency vibrations that they emit, and how far those can actually travel in terms of sound waves below the surface of the ground, and elephants can actually almost hear through their feet, is what some of the research is suggesting. They essentially pick up the vibrations of those low rumbling sounds and gives them a way of communicating over enormous distances. But their hearing is far better than yours or mine, or indeed any human being's. Their eyesight, on the other hand, is not fantastic. Relatively indistinct. They pick up on movement very clearly, but other than that, they generally can't see all that well. Which is why they very often chase little... I think it's one of the reasons why they chase things like Franklin. Because they just pick up on the movement. They don't really know exactly what's going on, so then they chase it. I've seen them run away from Franklin as well, which is hilarious. Watching an enormous animal like an elephant race away from something as tiny as a bird. Their sense of smell is also incredibly acute. And Laura, who's also watching in Canada, like Rachel, Laura wants to know, as we watch this elephant slowly attempt to devour the boobin, how fast the trees regrow once the elephants have fed off them. It's a difficult question to answer because they sometimes kill the tree. They can kill the tree just by pushing it over. It depends on the size of the tree. Depends on the age of the tree. The one thing is that elephants are essentially landscapers. They're very, very necessary. They're a crucial part of this ecosystem because they maintain the balance of tree and grass layers. I'm going to try and just reposition now that our bull has moved away from the boobin. So it's very difficult to answer that. They're very good. Trees are very resilient, though, and they're very good at doing what's known as coppicing. So when one is broken off, then a whole load of little branches grow up from it. And if we have a look at, there'll be a good example somewhere here. There must be. I wanted to show you what it looks like when a bush willow is pushed over. They often then start to grow, they'll have the main stem will be horizontal, and then it'll start to grow new stems vertically up from that horizontal main stem. I'll look for one, I'll find you one. I'm just sort of waiting here in the hope that the elephants find Karula for us. Perhaps they will send her out. Oh, they've sent something scurrying. Oh, it's a dacre, not a leopard. At the moment, the elephant's impact on the trees is particularly pronounced because, of course, they haven't got anything else to eat. And as a result, they're probably killing more trees than normal. So often what an elephant will do is stand around a tree and feed off it for a while. At the moment, they're particularly focused and dedicated whenever they happen to find a tree that is of particularly good value. Excuse me. It's actually quite nice sitting here watching them across the drainage line wall. Obviously found a good patch of vegetation there. And crazy critter. I was actually, funnily enough, I think you actually read my mind there in terms of what I was about to chat about, which was the fact that elephants are one of the creatures that are capable of eating tamboti trees, which are incredibly toxic to human beings, at least. And that's one of the reasons why it's important not to think that whatever an elephant eats is safe for human consumption. That goes without saying when they're munching on an acacia tree with enormous thorns. But if you've ever, I suppose a person could be forgiven for thinking if an elephant eats a bulb or something, it could be okay for humans, and that's definitely not the case. Now, Crazy Critter was wondering, if an elephant were to eat a plant that made them sick, would they remember it and not do that again? Yes, they would. Very, very smart animals, and with incredible brains, roughly three times that of a human. So, proportionately, ours are still bigger, but there's an immense amount of learning that goes on in an elephant's mind. They have highly, highly developed nerve pathways in their brain. So yes, they would learn and probably not eat that plant or make that mistake again. And they would teach the others. With their highly evolved social structures and the communication that they have between herd members, it's a very, very good chance that they would pass that message on to at least, especially, elephant calves. But for the most part, the only situation where an elephant would... The only real situation where an elephant would eat something toxic is in the case where it's an invader plant, if it's a foreign plant that's been introduced and that the elephant doesn't instinctively know to avoid. Otherwise, they're relatively good at knowing what they can eat and what they can't. Okay. I think the sitting waiting game for Karula to pop out isn't working, so we're going to try a loop around the block. Let's go across to James, who again has something much, much smaller than our elephants.
Ah, we still have it. It is a squirrel, everybody. A little tree squirrel. One of the few rodents we get here. And it's looking for nuts. quite in keeping with the general tradition of squirrels throughout the world, the tree squirrel of South Africa is a hoarder of nuts. Its preferred nut, of course, being the marula nut, which it finds underneath, unsurprisingly, marula trees, and it then hides them inside cavities, often in marula trees. Now, the other thing that there were over here were two rather sweet little crested Franklin, but they've now... I was going to say they've gone behind a bush, but I think David's got them.
No, I don't.
You don't. I wouldn't worry about them. They weren't particularly confiding, and I got very irritated there because I failed to take a picture of them, despite the fact that they were in the right place for a perfect amount of time. Irritating! Right, let's carry on. The other thing I did while you were away is I heard a whole lot of starlings shouting at each other, squawking, and I thought, that must be the lions or leopard, but it wasn't. It was just some spat over a territory, I think, and they looked to be much more interested in chasing each other than they were in alarming at a predator that we would like to see. Hello, Kevin in Montana. You're wondering what my favourite animal to watch is. Kevin, my favourite animal to watch unquestionably is the African wild dog. They are exciting, they're active, they are egalitarian, which means that they have a society that we can sort of relate to, in that they like to sort of help each other, and they look after the weak and sick and old and infirm, which I think we as all, well, all human beings find that particular trait very attractive. So that's really nice about them. I enjoy their, well, just enjoy the way they look, really. And there's something just tremendously familiar about them, which makes me enjoy spending time with wild dogs. The other thing about them, of course, is that you can spend time with them on foot. And they, if you spend time on foot with them, they will become quite confiding, and they don't see people as prey, and at the same time they're not terrified of us, which means you can actually spend time on them with them on foot, and not quite move with them, but you can move around them, which is just very special. Right, we're going to leave this area and start to head back towards the north, I think. Hello, Joel in New York. You're wondering when they leave their den, the wild dogs. Joel, they probably have started leaving the dens now already. The cubs or the pups, which were born to two of the packs in this area, I'm just trying to think. I think were born in mid-June, early July, which is quite early. And so they are now, what is that, July, August, September, 2 months old. About 3 months they'll start kind of moving with the pack. But they won't, at 2 months, they will probably not be denning anymore at all. And do one last loop through the Wamati. And just see if we don't come very lucky with something here. And then we're going to head back towards the north, back to the original place where we had those cubs, simply because it's quite possible that the adults will have returned from whatever sojourn they've been on. So we had three there. Yeah, I don't know where the others are. Hello, Rut. You want to know if there's anything out here that really scares me? Rut, yes, there is. The girls in the final control terrify the wits out of me. So I'm very nervous of getting home. It's always quite a relief to go out into the bush where you can be away from them, because they're quite terrifying ladies. That's the first thing that terrifies me. No, you know what? There's nothing out here at the moment that terrifies me. When I started doing this job, not this particular job, but working out here, absolutely everything terrified me, and that's because I didn't know anything. And so the greater my knowledge has become, the less fearful I've become. And that's not to say that I'm ever complacent. Well, I try not to be complacent about animals out here. So we were sitting just now less than 2 feet away from an elephant. And there's a certain weariness, though, but with knowledge, that fear has gone from fear to weariness and awareness. And so, no, I wouldn't say there's anything out here that terrifies me particularly. Were I to go tracking on foot lions with cubs, that would make me deeply fearful. Yes, does have to happen sometimes, but I suppose that would probably be the only thing that made me truly quite nervous. Obviously, you can get into a situation where there are lots of things that can make you nervous, like a charging elephant that got really upset. That can make you pretty scared, but you know, just sitting here now, I'm very comfortable. I'm not sort of looking around the corner thinking, well, I hope I don't see such and such, because it's very terrifying. Which wasn't the case when you start working in a place like this. And it's an interesting one, because, I mean, I think that's a really interesting discussion, because in, well, certainly in South African society, let me go up here, many societies, but men in South Africa specifically, they're never scared of anything, of course. You know, you never ever admit to being afraid of anything at all. And at the same time, we're also very convinced that we need to come across as tremendously brave. So when you describe working in an area like this, in the bush, you often hear people describe it in terms that would make the average mortal think that, you know, our lives were in danger on an almost continuous basis, such as the braveness and courage required to do the jobs that we do out here. Not so, David. Yes, very brave and stoic we are. But in actual fact, it's once you are used to the atmosphere out here, once you've got used to it and once you understand the animal behavior here, it's no more dangerous living here than it is living in a city. In fact, it's probably less so. But that's only once you are familiar with the animal behavior and you can navigate your way around a potential threat. I always say a human being is far less predictable than any animal out here. I find the animals out here, to a large extent, behave in an entirely predictable manner if you are able to put your sort of self in their shoes. So, for example, an elephant sees you as a predator. And, sorry, this ridiculous radio. An elephant sees you as a threat, as a predator, and if you understand that, you can understand completely how it behaves. So if you put it into a position where it feels cornered, you're going to have a reaction. Same with a buffalo, same with a lion or a leopard. They all see us as predators, and it is predictable how they behave depending on how you are making them feel. And once you realize how that happens, well, so the fear of being out here slowly dissipates to a gentle weariness. I hope that makes sense. Let's go and get an update from Jamie on her leopard tracking expedition. We're going to blast our way north back to the original place we saw the cubs.
I saw James, actually. He's not that far away from where we are now. In terms of our update on our leopard tracking, I've left that particular patch for now. And I'm moving a little bit further afield just to wait for those elephants to move away so that we can go back and check for her there. And so for now we're just bumbling along to see what it is we can find for you. I can't go walking Queen Karula just yet, otherwise the elephants are going to be very upset with me. James was talking about what scares him. Lioness with cubs is a good one. Angry elephants can also be quite scary, especially an angry elephant herd. And females are exceptionally protective over their little ones, and I think there's a female coming into estrus with that herd, and that's why they're so unsettled and that male is pushing them so hard. One thing I've definitely noticed, we've spoken about our different predators, there are lots and lots of hyena tracks around at the moment. I still think it's worth perhaps doing the odd den check. I still do it. Every time I go past one of the old den sites, if I've got a little bit of time, then I just drive in and check that they're not around there or that there's no sign of them going in. But it's usually quite easy to see whether or not they're using a den site because their tracks are on the road. Like all animals, they learn very quickly to utilize human roads. So they very often use the two tracks that we go into their den sites with. But there's quite a few tracks around. All right, I thought that impala was a lion. I'm a little bit disappointed. Not that he's not lovely, but I thought it was a lion. It's not a lion. Got very excited. He wasn't standing looking at me like that, with the horns up, otherwise I definitely would have known it was an impala. Keeping a close eye on us. I bet he knows where those lions are. Their tracks are absolutely everywhere. I know that Rex is working hard at finding them. Okay. Not a lion, an impala. Hmm. Just doing a sort of a summary of our different predator species, Donna, you wanted to know how often we see cheetah on cheetah plains. When was the last time we saw cheetah was on Brent's, well, sort of saw cheetah was on Brent's birthday. But that was, they were so far away, they were in Mala Mala. Once every, what would we say, once a month? Maybe less? Once every 2 months? We've gone through a little bit of a dry spell at the moment with cheetah. We haven't seen them properly in what feels like forever. James, I think, had the last proper sighting on cheetah plains around 3 in a row pan, and that must have been at least a month ago. So probably about once a month to once every 2 months we get to see them. And they've got enormous... Cheetah have... I really want to get that beautiful bushrike on camera. Let me try. Not often we see them in the open. Oh. Ah. Sorry, bee eaters. No, it is a bushrike. There's a whole load of bushrikes there. I thought I was going crazy. Look at that. Aren't you beautiful? Orange-breasted bushrikes hopping about. They really are truly striking birds. And there were three of them at one point. I think they're having a little bit of a disagreement. I suppose it is breeding season. Here's number three. How beautiful are they? I want to show you a picture of something. I'm just looking for it in my book. Now we get the grey-headed and the orange-breasted bushrikes are the ones that we commonly get to see out here. There is an amazing bushrike called the gorgeous bushrike. Just find it. And it is one of my absolute favourite birds.
And
here is it. Oh, there it is. And Lady Lone Wolf, on the subject of birds, you want to know what my favourite bird is. I'll show you in a moment. But this is one of the prettiest bushrikes. Not my favourite bird, but it is one of my favourite bushrikes. The gorgeous bushrike. They are absolutely, as the name suggests, absolutely gorgeous. So related to the little bird that we've just seen hopping about now in the trees, which is on this page. Sorry, I'm trying to see whether or not I can find it for you quickly. Orange-breasted, nope. I'm not going to spend too much time trying to find it. So that's the gorgeous bushrike, which we don't really see here, but I would love to see them. Very easily identifiable gentle whistling call. Right, my favourite bird is the... Find a picture of it quickly. Is the black eagle, or the Verroes eagle. We don't call them black eagles anymore, we call them Verroes eagles. They are my absolute favourite. It's a very strange thing when you swap the bird books. When you get a new bird book, because everything becomes incredibly unfamiliar to you. You don't know where anything is anymore. Whereas with the well-thumbed... My other bird book has been retired on the basis that I spilled coffee all over it. Sorry, I'll find it in 2 seconds. 102. There we go. That is my favourite bird. The Verroes or the Black Eagle. I think it stems from my grandfather telling me stories of when he used to... Because he actually found the Verroes eagle nest in the now Johannesburg Botanical Gardens. Or what is it called now? The Albertlatuli Gardens.
Walter Sisulu.
Walter Sisulu, that's it. Thank you very much, Brian. It was one of the struggle heroes. It was Walter Sisulu. And they have a nest there. They've been nesting there for years and years and years and generations. Right back to when my grandfather used to wander those particular rocky hills. Now that's my favourite bird, I think. It's hard to choose because I also really like the little owl species. Little pearl-spotted owlet or a barred owlet. Those are absolutely high up on my list. I'd have to choose a top five. Pearl Spotted Owlet, Rose Eagle Owl, I'll think about the others. Sorry, Rose Eagle. I'd have a Rose Eagle Owl, but that's not on my top five. While we go looking for something a little bit larger than our feathered friends, let's go back to James and see how he's going.
There's a monkey in there. Well done, David. And it thinks it's hiding from us, you see. But it isn't. We could see it. Sitting on the ground very happily, and the one thing that I've been wondering about them at the moment is what they're eating without the sort of source of fruits and new buds and things. That's what they like to eat normally. And I think they're probably eating quite a few termites, the odd moth that they're able to find. I'm sure they also find quite a lot in the way of chrysalises and other sort of pupating insects that you and I wouldn't know where to look for. He's got quite bright eyes, doesn't he, David? And quite impressive eyelashes. That's very sweet. It was very quick on the super zoom button there, David. Very smooth. That's the male. And they're always a little bit skittish on the ground, of course. Because, well, it's just not quite as safe as being stuck up in a tree. I completely forgot what I was going to say there. Right, here we go. Let's carry on. We didn't get very far north, I'm afraid. We had to turn back south because there are a whole lot of elephants in the way. So now we're going back north. No word on the lions. In fact, nothing has been called in on the radio at all. Still, it's been a gloriously beautiful morning. What was that, David? Oh dear. David's vat of water just fell over. Hello, Kill Playboy. I'm not sure how to take this, really. You say normally you're a troll on the internet. Kill Playboy, that is not a good thing. That is not something one should be admitting in public, Kill Playboy. Anyway, you have decided to dispense with your trolling ways today and join us and say that you're really enjoying the stream and you really wanted to see monkeys. Well, that's excellent. Thank you very much, Kill Boy. What was it? Forgotten it now. Kill Playboy, Kill Playboy. And may we all congratulate you in dispensing with your trolling ways and wish you a collective hiatus from internet trolling while you watch Safari Live. Welcome to it, and thank you for getting hold of us in the most untroll-like fashion. That is amazing. We'll try and find you some more monkeys if you promise not to troll. We're on a road now called Vulture's Nest Road. And the most notable thing about Vulture's Nest, David, is a... negative. It is in fact a Gymnogene's nest, or an Africa Harrier Hawk's nest. And it's in this tree here. There's a beautiful torchwood that I've tried to climb into, but unfortunately it is a bit difficult. And I'll just quickly show you the nest, because of course now is nesting season for many of the birds. Oh, sorry, Dave, tell me when the sun's out the way. It's the one in the big pile of sticks there. You're on it. Shall I stop here? Forward, back? Sideways?
That'll work.
No. No, David, to the right of that. Down a little. And I'll zoom in on that fork. To the right. There, you're on it. There. Down. You're in it. Now, I'll brighten the picture a little. Oh, dear. Here we are. That is the pile of sticks that is the nest of the Gymnogene or African harrier hawk. I'm just trying to see if there's anything in it, but I don't think there is. I think it's just the sticks. I've never actually seen one in there, but I know that it has been used by one. Right, on we go. Nothing else going on there. We've got the Wahlberg's nest so far. Let's keep a count of our nests, everyone. We've got the Shikra nest. We have got the Wahlberg's eagle's nest. And James Richard, you want to visit the vulture's nest. You mean the one on Arethusa? I'm not going to go there this morning, James. But yes, we can certainly go back there, I suppose, sometime during the course of the afternoon. But what happens with the vulture's nests, of course, is that they tend to be fairly non-seasonal breeders, which means that they are not in the process like the Shikra or the Wahlbergs of building up the nest now and then having a chick. I think they quite often have their chicks actually in the winter months. So not quite as summery, if you like. Hello, Shelley. You're wondering whether the Wahlberg's chicks commit siblicide. You've heard me say that the second egg doesn't hatch. I was doing a bit of reading after I said that to you yesterday. There's some warthogs there, Davy, that don't want to be on camera, but I think you should just put them on camera anyway. Not the best warthog sighting in the world, but we'll take it for now. Wahlbergs do lay 1 to 2 eggs, but apparently it is far less frequently 2 than I thought it was. And I don't think they engage necessarily in siblicide when there are 2, but it's unlikely that both would survive. So it is actually normally just 1 egg. I thought it was 1 or 2. And it was a sort of 50-50 that they did it, but it's actually apparently 95% of the time only 1 egg. So they don't engage in siblicide like Jamie's favourite bird, the Varroa or Black Eagle. I quite liked the Black Eagle when it was called the Black Eagle. I don't know, I found that very kind of simple and romantic rather than... You got him there, Davy. That was a very fast whip pan. Those warthogs are absolutely terrified out of their wits. It must have been the whip pan. You're in whip pan form today, Dave. And there was something... the Black Eagle is a really interesting one because I know Jamie was telling you about it. The very first bird, I think, or raptor, I think I ever remember noticing was when I was probably 14 or 15 years old. And I knew nothing about the bush. The only thing I knew was that when I was in a wild place, it made me feel good. But that was the sole thing that I knew about the bush. And I was sitting at a stable yard just outside of Johannesburg, now north of Johannesburg, and which is now, unfortunately, a very large squatter camp, but never mind that. It was kind of countrified. And I remember looking up at the sky. And it was probably about, 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a Johannesburg summer's day. And these 3 great sort of things appeared, flying, just gliding over. And there were 3 black eagles. Very unusual to see 3 of them together at all. Very unusual to see black eagles there. But that's what they were. And I remember being absolutely awed by them. They are really impressive. Now let us go. This is where we kind of began our search this morning. And we're just going to do a little search around more and see if we can't find perhaps the Ninkapuma pride. While we do that, let's head across to Jamie and find out what update she has on the Queen.
No updates on the Queen, I'm afraid. All is very, very quiet out here. And the Game Drive channel is incredibly quiet. I don't think it's been...
Broke some.
I spoke too soon. James is talking now. Asking, calling for Rexon to see what's happening. Right. So I spoke too soon. The Game Drive channel is not completely quiet. However, Andrew just finished off with a coffee stop and called in. Andrew from Cheetah Plains, one of the other guides. And he called in on the Game Drive channel and said, are there any updates? And Ephraim said nothing. There was a moment of silence and then Andrew said, confirm, nothing. So it's just one of those quiet mornings in the bush. Just one of those days where the animals are one step ahead of us, or behind us, or somewhere else. You've got to have quiet mornings. Well, not that the morning's over just yet, but you've got to have quiet mornings to keep things exciting. And hello to Ali. You want to know what the funniest or most memorable question is that I've ever been asked. I think one of my favorites was, is this a thorn tree? He was standing next to the tree at the time. It clearly had thorns. I wasn't quite sure how to answer that one. Sorry, distraction. I think we've seen, this morning we must have seen about 6 or 7 dacre. Lots of them moving about. Off he goes. It's a nice question, Ellie. Thank you for asking it. We do get some very bizarre ones. The thorn tree one was pretty funny. I mean, sometimes I off, occasionally with guests, I mean, we always talk about the fact that there's no such thing as a stupid question, and for the most part that is true, but sometimes people do ask questions without thinking first. Remember the one that Brent told me, when do the rhinos hunt? I've had a lot of, do you feed the lions? No, we don't. We don't feed the lions. This is not a zoo. I'm trying to think, what are the funniest ones I've been asked?
Do zebras eat meat?
Do zebras eat meat? Is that one that... do zebras eat meat? That's a good one. That's a very good one from Brian. And whilst there's no... We meant to say there's no such thing as a silly question. There is such a thing as a silly question. But we usually, they're few and far between. We usually understand where that person's coming from. If you've never experienced the African bush, then it's understandable. But if you are standing next to a thorn tree, I mean, it was an acacia tree like this one. If you are standing next to it and you ask me, is this a thorn tree? I'm going to have a good chuckle. Is this a thorn tree? I don't know. Touch it and find out. See how that works out for you. I remember picking a guest up from Polokwane, which is very, very far away, and I was very deeply disgruntled that for some reason he decided to book his flight to Polokwane, which is the capital city of Limpopo, but it is a good, must be about 4-hour drive away. So it's difficult, it's time consuming to get there. So you'd already started off on a bad foot, although that wasn't his fault, poor chap. And he didn't have any idea why I was so disgruntled with him. And he kept asking me when we were going to see some of the exotic animals. I'm trying to tell him that they're not exotic if they come from here. Then they're just animals. They're just animals that live here. He also then, which was hilarious, but also slightly terrifying. Now, Polokwane is the capital city of Limpopo. It's like all big cities. James was talking about the fact that... There's some dwarf mongoose over there. James was talking about the fact that it's scarier living in the city than a bush, and then in the bush. That's absolutely true. He went to the currency exchange and came bounding out with a roll full of money that he'd just exchanged for his dollars. He came bouncing out and waved it in the air and said, look what I just got. I mean, we're standing in the middle of a city. It was ridiculous, with people eyeing him up from every corner. So I snatched it away from him. We will talk about the dwarfmongers in a moment. So I snatched it away from him and I said, give that to me, I'll look after it for you. Don't go waving it around. And he said, no one's going to mug me. And I looked at him and said, I just mugged you. Just took it straight out of your hand. Anyway, there's some strange and interesting experiences that we've had. I did give his money back, yes. I did give his money back, eventually. But only when we were safely ensconced at camp where he couldn't spend it anyway. Dwarf Boggy is having a thorough grooming session. And some morning yoga. Having a jolly good groom and nibble. And I think they've had a bit of a late... I think they've had a bit of a late start this morning. It's chillier than normal. So they've been waiting for it to warm up. And now only just emerging, lazy mongoose, to head out and go and search for their daily meals. We had such an extraordinary sighting... When was it? 2 days ago. With the dwarf mongoose that was... breaking apart bark and then munching up the termites. A very, very special moment. You see the cautious way that they approach going out and about before dashing off. This one hasn't quite accepted the beginning of the day just yet. Off you go. Everybody else has left you behind. Or are you going to stay and perhaps look after little ones? It's possible. The dwarf mongoose do leave behind babysitters, but I don't think so. I think he's just being lazy. Here we go. Look at that. Fascinating. Scent marking. Rubbing its cheek along the branch. That was a scent mark. What they then do is they do handstands. I'm hoping he's going to do it for us now. They do handstands and anal paste, but they do it upside down. It's fascinating to watch them do it. Oh, no. Usually towards the end of the day, and they usually have set little spots that they anal paste on. So for those of you who think they're absolutely adorable and would make wonderful pets, think again. Unless you would enjoy having your furniture covered in dwarf mongoose anal paste. They've also got very sharp teeth, and speaking from experience, are not afraid to use them. Poor old Steph and the mongoose that was hanging from her eyelid. I had one hanging from my septum, from my nose. Same mongoose. I'm also sorry, I've been distracted. I've been thinking about the question that we asked about the silliest question, and then I've started to think about the silliest events that I've had occur. I had one girl that didn't drink water for 3 days, didn't drink anything for 3 days because she didn't like the way it tasted. As you can imagine, she then got very ill very quickly, and she managed to dehydrate herself spectacularly quickly. Seeing as it was sort of 35 degrees every single day. But she didn't like the taste of the water, so she didn't drink it. And then wondered why she felt so terrible. And then I tried to get her to drink and she wouldn't. She kept refusing and saying it was revolting. It really wasn't. It was not that bad. Ah. Off they go. Okay, little ones. I'm going to leave you be. Good luck with your day's foraging. Keep an eye out to the sky. Make sure you don't get swiped up by any eagles. And off we go. We probably... They've all dispersed now. They've all disappeared. But we probably saw about 8 or 9 mongoose there. And David in Napa, welcome to the Sunrise Safari. You wanted to know how many mongoose live in, dwarf mongoose live in a group. It's usually around, I would say, 8 or 9, 10 that we see. Sometimes you do get bigger groups, but that's, whoopsie, got distracted by the old Dacre kill that was in the tree. Very, very old. It's now disappeared. Yes, you sort of around 8, 9, or 10. You sometimes get the bigger ones, and sometimes, obviously, you get splits of different groups when they get too large, or when little ones disperse when they reach sexual maturity and they go off and form their own little groups. And we get to know because they've got their tiny little territories. You're talking sort of not much larger than about, depending on the area, probably about 8 or so hectares. And we get to know the different groups. So there's about 13 of them that live on quarantine, and there's a couple that live around Treehouse Dam. The one at Buffalo's Hook Dam, which I think might be the same one that we saw earlier, that we saw now, numbers about 15 in total. One of the only sociable mongoose species, apart from the banded mongoose, which we never get to see. I missed my turn off. I was planning on going down Hyena Road, but I think I might have missed... Oh no, there it is. So busy distracted thinking about the answer to the silly question. Whenever I drive past here, I always triple check and see whether or not the white-faced owls are not in the vicinity. And this was their tree that they spent a lot of time in, but it doesn't look like they're here. Nope. Nobody home. Not today, at least. And while we continue along Buffalo's Hook cutline, let's go across to James and find out where in the world he is and how his search for the lion cubs is going.
This may have been a very bad idea. There seems to be some fairly loose bark arranged on this tree. Always wanted to climb it, feeling very nervous. I think we're okay, Dave. There's another piece here, David. Yes, I'm sure it looks pretty cool, but bits and pieces of the tree are detaching at an alarming rate. Hello everyone. I've come up here to look for lions. But I haven't seen any. The reason we came down here was because we went to Hyena Road first, where Rexon said he thought he saw the tracks going. Now, I don't know... Many of you have been watching for some time now, and we've been watching the Nkuhuma Pride in that very large drainage line called the Mluamati, just to the east of the Gowrie cut line. Now, I mean, that's not, you don't need to remember any of those names or anything like that, but it's not far from where we've had those cubs today. And I wonder if they haven't come into this area. And Rexon said, come and check Hyena Road and then go and check Buffalo's Hook Dam. There's nothing at the dam. I'm not surprised by that, of course, because there's no water there. But somewhere around here, the Nkuhuma Pride is, with the rest of the cubs. Quite possibly, they're on a kill. And I think that's why they've left those three youngsters there. And interestingly, I think it was three youngsters, or two teddy bear cubs, so the very little ones, and one of them that's a bit older, so about, I think I've decided they were 11 or 12 weeks old. That leaves, of course, the two that are missing. That was a teddy bear and I think the other 12-week-old one. And that leaves us with another three, which are the older cubs. So what's interesting here is I think maybe the older cubs of 14 or 15 weeks are now moving with the pride. Perhaps they've been taken to the kill. They may have been walking with the pride. It's very young for them to be moving with the pride, but maybe that's what's happened. And the three younger ones have been left while the rest of the pride went hunting. And the other two, quite possibly still lost. So who knows? I might be talking absolute nonsense there, but that's what I think's happened. Right. Now, David, this tree is definitely rotting much more than I thought it was. If you watch this. Coming off. So I'm a little bit nervous. My daddy always said, you must never climb down something frontwards. You must... A little awkward, you know. But here we go. yes, it is rotting. David, you will apply your first aid... You haven't done the first aid course, have you? You're the only one that hasn't. You will roll on it. Good. You mean so that we can send a picture of my demise to somebody more medically trained than you are. Wonderful. I'm quite nervous, I can't tell you a lie. This tree is not sturdy anymore. Anyway, we should be okay. The only thing I'm worried about, of course, is a large snake or scorpion emerging from a hole and biting me on me undercarriage, because that is the most exposed part at the moment. Once we get to here, we should be all right. Yes. There we are. Now it's just a bit slidey. I think I'm just going to jump. Thank you. I did hear a... which is the kind of sound a reptile would make. You know, David, the things I do for this show, the sacrifices I make, personal risks I take, well done, everybody. I know that wasn't a particularly biological segment, but, well, there wasn't much leaf on that tree to show you about, and I wasn't about to retrieve a scorpion with my bare hands from the middle of the tree. I'll find you some biology now. Here we go. Hello, Laura. You're wondering about snakes? Are there any here? You say you've been watching for some time, but you haven't seen any snakes. Laura, there are lots and lots of snakes here, but snakes like us less than we like them. And so they avoid us like the plague. They hear the vehicles coming, they feel our vibrations, they hear our voices, and they hide away from us. And that's why we don't see a great number of them. But of course, as we go towards the summertime now, the temperature heats up, and of course there'll be a bit of moisture, hopefully, fairly soon. That will bring the snakes out, and then we might see them on the roads. We sometimes see them fossicking about in the trees. Mambas will start to move between the holes in the ground, between the termite mounds, where they go and look for things like those dwarf mongoose you were looking at with Jamie. They would be particularly scared of the infamous black mamba. And puff adders we could find lying on the ground of an evening, trying to sort of warm up, especially just before we go into the kind of real heat. So yeah, I think this is a good time to be watching if you like to see snakes. Laura, do you like snakes? Lots of people seem to be utterly terrified of them, but yes, I think you will see some. Jono, you want to know if it's true that black mambas will chase people. Jono, like most facts that people know about snakes, it is completely untrue. What black mambas do, they are very territorial. And what that means is that if you get between them and where their hole, where they want to be, they'll go towards that. And then it seems like you're being chased, but it is highly, highly unlikely, to the point of being near impossible, that a black mamba will actually chase you. And I've watched a guy, he's a wonderful chap, he's a real kind of eccentric, called Donald Stradom. And Donald Stradom has run a reptile park just outside Hoedspruit for a very long time now. And he's done lots of TV stuff with reptiles, especially with mambas. He's never been bitten before, and he said he actually did a whole sort of segment in a show once to demonstrate what nonsense this was, that black mambas chased humans. And he chased one. They found one out in the open, and he got out of the car and he ran at it. He chased it. And it looked at him like that, and it booked out. It didn't want anything to do with him, and it made no attempt to turn and face him. If you corner a mamba, you'll be in big trouble. And sometimes the dangerous thing about this, these snakes, is that you can corner them without realizing it. And then you can be in trouble, and then they will bite you multiple times. And that will be very unpleasant, David. Then you will need first aid training. Hello, James Richard. You say we often talk about how, or talk about the reactions that lions and leopards have to us on foot versus in the vehicle. How would they react to us in a tree? James, I think that if they smelt and saw you in a tree, they'd know exactly what you were. I'd be interested, I think a leopard would just walk away. I'd be interested in a lion's reaction though. It'd be quite interesting, because you would be very much behaving like a monkey. And a monkey, of course, is fair game to a lion, and I think that they would be quite interested. And a lion is not scared to go up a tree and try and fetch something out of the tree if it can. And so you might find yourself in some trouble. I would far rather meet a lion on foot than I would in a tree. Climbing a tree would be the last thing I did if I was trying to get away from a lion, unless I knew that I could climb into the very tip top of it, where the lion was just simply too heavy to go. But you don't want to be sitting in a tree with a lion trying to hook you out. Well, maybe some people do. I don't, though. Okay, we're going back to the original spot now. And while we do that, let's go to Jamie and get an update from her.
We're trundling along down Hyena Road. I was hoping, against hope, that perhaps Hyena Road would work its magic and something wonderful might decide to pop out. Now, of course, the story behind Hyena Road was Gendre, 2 seconds before the lions came pelting out, chasing buffalo, saying, "We never see anything on Hyena Road." Hence, Hyena Road has become something of a magical road. Unfortunately, today, it seems as though it has let us down. There's not even a waterbuck. There's usually at least one waterbuck on Hyena Road. But they've all gone into hiding. But that's okay. The mysteries will wait to be unfolded this afternoon on the Sunset Safari. I know that Brent is coming back today. After a week's leave, he's been out fishing with Connor and with Viam, although I don't think Viam did any fishing. Viam returned yesterday to much cheering and applause, because of course, first of all, Viam is a wonderful person to have around camp, and second of all, he is technological. I remain convinced that Viam is a secret agent. So having him return is always hugely beneficial to our team. And Connor is back as well, also. And we're very happy to have all of our team slowly starting to regroup and regather. The only thing I can tell you this morning is that the lions were everywhere last night. Now, James, good morning and welcome on our sunrise safari. You were wondering what sort of hoops we had to jump through in order to get to where we've got to, what career path we chose. And we've all got very different stories to how we ended up here. Hold on. We've got an Ellie fight happening. A little bit of a sparring match. Keep going. Sorry, James, can I put your question on hold for one moment? Don't want to get too close because I think they're going to stop what they're doing. Although I think that's now in the worst possible positioning. The male on the left is clearly much larger than the one on the right. Retreat. It's just a game. Having some fun. Teenage boys pushing each other around. Hello, little boys. You can hear the sound of the tusks knocking together. One's got the size advantage, the other has a tusk advantage. But size is what really counts. See, pushing him further and further back. Oh, look at that, he's actually got his head between the tusks and pushing it right down. Oh, there we go. Back up again. That's nice to see. The elephants have been much less playful over the last few weeks, which makes sense because obviously they are far more focused on feeding than anything else. But it's nice to see them play every now and again. All bluster. Oh, retreat! Retreat. You can see there's a very clear size difference. The bull pressing home his advantage. Oh, and off they go. Let's see if we can reposition. So while we do, James, you wanted to know how we ended up where we did. I did a law degree once upon a time. Obviously my legal career's going swimmingly. And then went off to train to be a guide. And then worked in research guiding rather than actual lodge guiding. So taking around people who did their PhD and so on different animals, as well as volunteers, helping with the monitoring of the different animals of the reserves. And I ended up here purely by chance. I happened to go onto the Fugazza website to check and see whether or not I was all paid up and fully sorted for that year. And I saw the advert and I mentioned it as a joke. And my mom immediately said, and my brother immediately said, you have to go and try it. And here we are, over a year later. And I think we've all sort of stumbled into this job in different... I mean, Brian's had the most amazing background.
I'm a trained 3D animator.
There you go. So Brian is a trained 3D animator who has... you're basically self-taught.
Yeah.
He's a self-taught cameraman and a brilliant one at that. And you have to be. When you're filming things like this elephant scuffle... off they race. Either way, I think we're all very glad for the paths that led us to where we are today. Let's go across to James, who's got a lovely little bird to show you.
That, everybody, is something we hear a lot, but we don't see very often. It is the black-crowned chagra, and it has the following beautiful call. You can see that the chagra is not in the least bit confused. It certainly doesn't think that there's a chagra sitting next to it. And what they're looking for, lizards, insects, tadpoles, believe it or not, or small snakes. And they're not going to find tadpoles or small snakes knocking about there, but they could easily find some insects to eat. And they're shrikes. You can see that very obvious shrike-like beak with a little tooth at the end of it. And this is probably a little couple. And they are monogamous. It's, well, they're monogamous breeders. That doesn't mean that they are monogamous forever. So in one breeding season, they'll be monogamous. And they build a shallow sort of cup, a nest cup, a typical sort of bird's nest in a shrub about, say, 5 feet off the ground. They could also be looking for nesting material at this time of the year. Look at the brilliant, brilliant coloration compared with the leaves. Isn't that amazing? That reddish chestnut copper color on the back of the bird is exactly the same as the leaves. It is also smaller than a piece of elephant dung. Do you see that there, David? Yes. It can hide behind elephant dung, should it require. So cool. This lens is amazing that we're able to see these birds so intimately. We did go back to the where the lion cubs were this morning. There's no sign of them there now. So we're just going to let things be for a little while, I think, and see how they play out. Keep watching the dam cam during the course of the day and see if those lions don't pitch up. All right, from the Chagras, David and I, we say goodbye to you and we'll see you this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Until then, stay safe and happy, and I'll leave you with Jamie and the elephants.
Oh, our elephants have decided that since it is the end of the sunrise safari, they're going to slowly disappear off into the bush. They did continue their scuffle. I think they've been having a wonderful time. So for the last few moments, let's see if we can stay with them. I'm just going to go forward now a little bit. I'm going to roll forward. Oh, come on. Come on, Wendy. You can do it. Ah, oh, gravity's just not quite in our favour. Oh, and it's time for a break for breakfast. And set aside their differences and decided to just enjoy some food. Oh, spike thorn again. It's definitely not going to be a very pleasant way to start off a morning breakfast. Not the most nutritious of trees. This one's doing slightly better. Munching on a fallen knobthorn. And so, it is that we're coming to the end of our sunrise safari. Excuse me. I think this afternoon we will have to try once again to track down the queen and, of course, those elusive lions, since they keep vanishing. At least there's lots and lots of elephants around to keep us occupied. Hopefully these young bulls will be up to their shenanigans this afternoon as well. A beautiful, peaceful way to end off a morning drive. There've definitely been lots of elephants around. It's weird. It seems as though we go through phases where there's no elephants at all, and then all of a sudden they've all come back. There's herds absolutely everywhere. Hopefully they will stick around for our sunset safari and we'll get to spend a little bit of time with them as well. Come on, boys. Oh, I thought they were going to scuffle again, but unfortunately not. And we are slowly but surely reaching the end. It's time for us. The elephants are having their breakfast. It's time for us to head across and enjoy some of Amanda's amazing cooking, which I feel like I can smell from here. I'm so hungry. And so it's time for us to say our goodbyes and our thank yous. So a big thank you to Brian, and a very well done, as of course, to the Thumb as well, in the Thumb's standard morning attire. Always gets dressed officially for work in the mornings, as well as to the lovely ladies of Final Control, to Kirsty, to Lou and to Jerry, and then most importantly, a vast and enormous thank you to all of you watching across the globe. We'll catch up with you for the sunset safari, but until I see you again, have a wonderful day wherever you happen to be, and we'll catch you then. Bye-bye, everybody.